Come up, don't be shy. Nobody in this room is shy. That I'm sure of. Yeah, I'd say there's a couple of dozen seats up here in the front, folks. Okay, we're going to try to get started soon, but we invite you to grab a chair. There are still chairs up here. I think more chairs are being added in the back, are they, Daniel? I saw chairs being carried. Do we have enough chairs in the back for people who are standing? There's about six more empty seats up here. Yeah, the second row over here on this side has some seats, and the third and fourth row have a couple of seats over here. How's everybody? Yeah, great. You're full of joy, aren't you? Full of joy.
Angry.
I'm angry.
I'm going to
read you a tweet. And I have the permission of the person who wrote this tweet to read it. Some of you, if you're on Twitter, you know Gordon Little. Not all of you would be on Twitter, but Gordon is somebody who's been pretty public about stuff, and he wrote me today in the midst of a series of communications, and I'm reading it because I'll show you. These are emails that I've received. There are hundreds of emails here. I have hundreds of tweets. I also have hundreds of Facebook messages. What Gordon writes here is repeated over and over and over again in those emails that I have, and the language he's using is the same language. And it's so succinct because it's a tweet. I thought this would be a good thing to read. Lorraine, I'm scared. Keep hearing that word over and over. We've already cut everything we can. No TV, this is before this budget. This is how they live. No TV, no home phone, no dance for kids, one car, one job, and five mouths. And he's a public service sector worker. That's their reality. That's their reality now. And what people like Gord are saying to me in all of their emails, they're sitting down and they're spending their time doing the math. And I'm getting messages. We're just making it now. They're looking for $3,000 or $4,000 more from us. We don't have it. A lot of them, doing the math, Lorraine, we're not sure, $3,000 to $6,000, we haven't got it. Another email there from a woman who calls herself, well, I really got to get it out and read it because it's really too good. I can't do it on my own. I'll save it till for later. People are scared. They're frightened. They're spending their time crunching the numbers to see how they're going to be able to live, how they're going to be able to feed the children and buy them clothes. One woman says, we feed the kids, we try to give them what we can, and occasionally I can buy a pair of new shoes. I don't know what we're going to do. These are middle class people, folks. These are our middle class who are saying this. We're in the House of Assembly facing a government that is getting these same emails. A lot of those emails I get have been sent to all of the MHAs. They're getting no response back, and we're getting no response from the government. Jerry and I are doing the same thing. We're presenting the real faces. Kathy Bennett stood up in the House of Assembly on Thursday and said, we were fear-mongering. Dwight Ball almost got me thrown out of the House of Assembly today. He was so convinced I was fear-mongering, when all we are doing is bringing the voice of the people to the House of Assembly. And while Jerry and I are doing that in the House, because there were some people intelligent enough to vote two of us in, we also have our wonderful leader, who people weren't smart enough to vote in, but who is doing his job outside of the House. Every chance Earle gets, he's on Open Line, he's on Back Talk, he's on the morning shows, he's putting out his weekly messages to the members of the party. He's speaking out. So the three of us are working together. Two of us in the House, one outside, and we are a caucus together. And I am so proud that Earle is doing his job as leader and is a full member of our caucus. And I'm so proud that he wanted tonight, as leader of the NDP, to call this town hall. I don't have to give you any bios on Earle. We know who he is. I'm going to stop talking, and now he's going to talk to you.
Lorraine and I were never meant to share the same mic. Thanks everybody for coming out tonight. There are a few seats. I'm familiar with the concept of people taking seats from the front, taking them around back. A guy in Marystown once told me this is like church. You got to arrive early to get a good seat in the back. But anyway, thanks to everybody for coming out. We're here tonight because we know there is a lot of the kind of fear and concern that Lorraine talked about. There's also a lot of anger around at what government is doing with this really draconian budget. We're here to talk about, you know, some of the impacts that has on people. We've been trying to get that kind of information in the House of Assembly, and anyone who follows the news will know that, you know, there's more condescension than there is answers. They call it question period for a reason. They sure don't call it answer period. Because while there's lots of questions, there's few answers. And today, the Minister of Finance, in the face of a budget like that, when questioned about it, said to one of the members on the other side of the House, the opposition members, I'll speak more slowly if you need me to. Yeah. Now, is that the best they can do, faced with, and when people are asking a legitimate question from people who have the kind of concerns that Lorraine mentioned there? So the idea of this meeting is we want to hear from people, from you, how the budget affects you. I got a few words to say first, and then I'll mercifully stop, but we'll open it up because we're trying to find out what analysis did they actually do before they brought down that budget. Because I don't know what would be worse if they did the analysis of what the impact would be on people at different income levels with different circumstances and went ahead anyway, or they didn't even bother to do it all. Either way, that budget fails the people of this province. And that's why we're all here tonight. So done my best to get around. It was interesting. Gambo, which I'm told by the people out there, is not a, oh, there's someone from Gambo. Great, how do you do? I'm told it's not a place that's famous for people staging public demonstrations. I couldn't say, I'm sure, but that's what they told me. Anyway, they had a sponsor. One individual took it upon himself to organize, Michael Paul, organize a young man to organize an event last Saturday. So I took a spin out to say hello. And there was Jerry Earle was there, 150 people, I suppose, or two, between 150 and 200 people in a town of a little over 1,000. Now that's what happens when people are really concerned about something. And they feel like they've really been double-crossed, that they're promised one thing in an election campaign, and then what they get in the reality is something altogether different. Then there'll be other occasions. I'm going to do my best to get around whatever events there are around the province, because I know this is a serious matter for a lot of people. I want to touch on some of the favorite talking points the Liberals have, because they have somebody, some spin doctor, saying, here, no matter what the question is, answer this. So here's the standard answers that I've spotted, usually given with a furrowed brow. These are tough decisions. We're all in it together. Everything is on the table. Except for food. Good. I'll remember that one. And my favorite of all, not. We had no choice. Well, first of all, did you ever notice that the tough decisions are rarely tough on the people who make them? Did you ever notice that while we're all in it together now, we weren't all in it together during the days of, wine and roses? And it's only in the tough times all of a sudden say, look, we're all in it together. Because the people who benefit precious little, if at all, from the rosy times are the ones who are now taking it on the chin in the tough times. Everything is on the table. To me, that's another way of saying we stand for nothing. Because there are some things that should be on the table. If you're a political party, you should have some things to say, here are the basic values we believe in. And those aren't on the table. We're going to build a budget around those values, and there are other matters that we're willing to talk about as to how we proceed. And we had no choice. Folks, a budget is all about choice. Any government has choices. Sometimes your choices are more limited than other times because of circumstances, but there are always choices. Very interesting that on the same day in Canada, two budgets came down. Newfoundland and Labrador budget, and the Alberta budget. While Alberta is a better off province, had more favorable underlying circumstances, nonetheless, there are a lot of similarities. Both provinces pretty heavily dependent on oil revenue. Both had revenues seriously cut. Both had increased unemployment, worse than Alberta, actually, the increased unemployment. But the response was entirely different. Now, any politician, I suppose myself included, can say, here's what I will do or might do or do tomorrow. But in this case, we have an opportunity to look at here's what an NDP premier did. Not what they might do or promise to do, what they did. And I'll just read a brief section from the, because it was interesting. Do you know what they called the budget in Alberta, the title of it? The Alberta Jobs Plan. Because they recognized at a time when the private sector was shedding workers to the tune of at least 60,000 jobs lost, that the public sector, i.e. the government, there was a vacuum there that they had to step up and fill that to provide hope and opportunity for Albertans. And here's why I attended a speech that Rachel Notley gave a couple days before the budget. Here's what she said. And I read this because of the contrast to what we're seeing here. We're going to protect our core public services, understanding the key role they play in supporting Albertans and building our future. We're going to invest in our economy to create jobs and to diversify our economy, and we're going to manage public finances prudently without panic measures that just make things worse. Now, that last few words is a perfect description of the Newfoundland and Labrador budget. Panic measures that will only make things worse. So So when the Premier says he's not proud of the measures they adopted, and when a minister tells the media it's a bad budget, and when the government side members don't even applaud the minister's budget, which is the first I ever heard of that, then you know that they haven't had much of a budget. Now, having said that, I'd be the first to say that the minister did not deserve applause for an unfair budget that demanded way too much of those with little or nothing. The levy, of course, is the most egregious and blatant piece of inequity in the whole document. The idea, head tax, was a cover charge for being a Newfoundlander. But the idea that you'd have something that flies so in the face of the accepted understanding of progressive taxation, whereas you earn more, you pay a bigger share of that because you can afford it, and in fact really heaps the burden relative to income by far the greatest on people at the low end of the totem pole. And so the Premier actually defended it. And he spoke to a business audience out in Paradise a couple of weeks ago and said, you kind of chuckle, well, you know, we're already taxing the rich and they're already paying their fair share. Really. He also said that 35% of the population pay 88% of all taxes. Well, I like to call the Premier on that. I don't believe it. Table the documentation of that. They surely aren't paying 88% of the levy, or of the fuel tax, or of the tobacco tax, or of a whole lot of other tax. And his only defense of the levy that I've heard so far is that it's temporary. Well, that's an interesting concept. It's okay to implement an unfair measure as long as you only lay the wood to people temporarily. And as he was asked in a radio interview this morning, how do you really expect people to believe that it's only temporary when a couple of months ago you told them that you would, under no circumstances, would you increase the HST? Under your watch, there would be no layoffs in the public sector, etc., etc. You often use the word temporary today more often than a fast food recruitment officer. But it's what we have, folks, is really a budget, above all, is devoid of hope. Devoid of inspiration, vision, diversification. It's death by a thousand cuts. A budget that knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. Imagine, we have the highest rate of literacy of any province in Canada. We're the only province now to tax books, and we're just closing more than half the libraries in the province. Absolutely shameful. And I heard the Minister of Education, of all things, I watched him on television tonight, say that, well, you know, we're close, we have the highest rate of illiteracy in the country. So a solution is tax books and close the libraries. Well, I got to tell you, folks, I'm glad Dale Kirby is not the Minister of Health. Because we have the highest, I do believe we have the highest rate of heart disease in Canada. And by that line of reasoning, he shut down the cardiac unit at the Health Sciences Complex.
But they're doing it. They closed Masonic.
They've closed a lot of stuff, and we haven't seen the end yet. Seniors' dental coverage. Now, there's such a thing as trying to get at the root causes of problems. The things that really lead to greater, yeah, pardon the expression on that one. The ones that lead to deeper problems. The question I have for the Minister of Health, when they decided to discontinue that very valuable service for seniors, what estimate did they make of the downstream additional healthcare costs that will result from canceling that upfront intervention that helps people stay healthy? Answer, nothing. Didn't factor into it. And there's a host of I could go on and on about areas like that where there's subsequent consequences of the decision that they're not even factoring into calculation. It's unnecessarily complicated. It's hammering people all over the place with fee upon charge upon levy upon tax. And people, as Lorraine read out, haven't got the money to do it. And to make matters worse, by saying, you ain't seen nothing yet, just wait till the fall, they've got every single public sector worker in this province sitting on their wallet. Because if you think there's a real good chance you're going to get laid off in September, you're not going to go out in May and buy a fridge or a stove. You're going to squeeze every penny and only spend on the absolute essentials, which of course shrinks the economy and makes that situation worse. It actually says in the budget, and just to prove I'm not kidding you, not that I do that, I'll read from it. This is the Newfoundland Labrador no jobs plan. Several major economic indicators, like employment and real compensation of employees, will lower by 15% and 22% respectively by 2021 compared to 2015 levels. Provincial deficit reduction measures are estimated to account for 40 to 50% of predicted declines in these broad measures of economic activity. In other words, they admit right in their budget that this thing is going to fail, and that this is going to account for half of a very, very substantial drop in employment in the province. And we have no plan to, we not only do we have no plan to combat that, we do have a plan that will accelerate that. So no wonder the minister, whatever he's Eddie Joyce's minister was, he said it was a bad budget. It's a plan to fail. Or to paraphrase what the finance minister has been saying, honey, I shrunk the economy. And what I think they're doing, and we'll see that the other shoe will drop later this year, they're setting the table for privatization of public services. And here's how you do it. Here's the formula. First, you starve the service of resources. Then the complaints build up, like the people on the out around Riverhead or on the highway yesterday or today, whenever it was, saying, and I saw the pictures, unbelievable. The state of the road. And then they, you know, people complain because the services deteriorate so badly. Then they privatize. And that's how the elites look after their own. So I think this is, they actually directed the deputy ministers and the heads of agencies to examine every single service that government operates to see whether or not it's a candidate for privatization. They didn't have one single service that they deliver that they said, this is sacrosanct, this cannot be touched. Every single one of them. Can we privatize them?
They're right-wing Republicans.
Absolutely right-wing Republicans, and that's their good features. So a fair question, and two or three people or more, three or four asked me beforehand, what would you do differently? Because that's fair, it's all well and good to say what they did is no good, but unless we can say here's some things we do differently, then that's pretty lame. Now I haven't got a prescription for every item that we'd need a lot more resources than what we have, but I do have some basics I will touch on later. But right now, I'll mercifully take a break, because really the main purpose of the meeting was to hear from people on how the budget affects you. How does it affect seniors? How does it affect single moms? How does it affect nurses? How does it affect young families, etc.? How does it affect the disabled? How does it affect those with various kinds of issues? So what I would do is ask people who want to. There's a floor mic there, and if there's anyone who was a struggle to get to the floor mic, we got a portable one. We could this one. D-Link's here, and we could get that to you. So, really, what's the impact of the budget on you and your family is sort of what we're interested in hearing. So I will take a spell now and encourage people to come up. And if that, appreciate if you'd introduce yourself at the start.
Okay, maybe we'll get this mic put down over there so we'll have two mics on the floor. That would be helpful. And if you need a mic brought to you, Amanda, is there anybody on the floor who's in charge? Daniel is. Daniel right here. If you need a mic brought to you, Daniel will bring it to you. And I'm going to leave it to Earl to recognize people and recognize the mic you're at. We'll call this one over here mic one, and we'll call that mic two. Okay, go ahead, Earl. Well, I need to say one thing. You may notice there's an empty chair. We're still involved in budget debates, as you know. We have what are called estimates meetings, where we sit down and quiz departments. Well, Jerry's at an estimates meeting right now, quizzing the Department of Justice. And as soon as the estimates meeting is over, she'll join us.